Napoleon and the Battle of Eylau, 1807. Let's go!
January 1807. French Emperor Napoleon Bonaparte, victor of Ulm, Austerlitz and Jena, was near the height of his powers. His Grande Armée had swept all before it. Now, in the depths of a bitter Polish winter, he sought the final victory that would make him master of Europe.
Okay, let's go.
His target, the Russians, supported by the remains of the Prussian army. But many months of campaigning had exhausted even his toughest veterans.
So fucking sick.
Most had not seen France in years, and the war in Poland seemed to offer only freezing mud, hunger, and a stubborn enemy who did not know when he was beaten.
Sounds like your weekend, Jack.
At Poltusk, the Russians had fought courageously and thwarted Napoleon's first attempt to outmaneuver their army. But another opportunity would soon emerge. Command of the Russian army had recently passed to General Levin August von Bennigsen. Despite his German name and Hanoverian roots, he was a veteran of 34 years' service with the Imperial Russian army.
And what does Napoleon just think?
On the 27th of January, with 77,000 Russians and 13,000 Prussians, Bennigsen launched a surprise winter offensive, targeting Marshal Ney's exposed 6th Corps. But Ney escaped, and Bernadotte's 1st Corps fought a successful rearguard action at Morungen.
Nice. Okay.
Now, Napoleon would turn the tables on Bennigsen. As soon as he'd learned of the Russian advance, he'd begun planning a grand encirclement of the enemy.
Interesting.
Suddenly, it was the Russians who were exposed.
Nice.
But Bennigsen got wind of Napoleon's trap just in time.
Okay.
And began a hurried withdrawal.
Back and forth. Not one-sided just yet.
Mm-hmm.
5 days of relentless marching followed, with Marshal Murat's vanguard nipping at the Russians' heels all the way.
Goddamn.
But despite a series of furious assaults on their rearguard, ably commanded by Prince Bagration, the French could not break through. The pursuit continued, even as temperatures plummeted. To the north, Ney shadowed Lestock's Prussian Corps, while Soult's 4th Corps followed the Russian rearguard to the small East Prussian town of Eylau.
Loving hearing some of the old names come back.
Mate, that just looks like a war zone.
Oh, it really does. Day one. Let's go.
On the afternoon of the 7th of February, Marshal Soult's troops advanced up the icy road to Eylau.
Okay.
They found it held by General Barclay de Tolly's Russian division, entrenched along a line of fences, ditches, and barricades. Just before dusk, confused combat began around the town cemetery. More and more troops were sucked into the bitter fighting.
That's where the war was from.
The French took the cemetery with a bayonet charge, but then had to hold it against a determined Russian counterattack,
led by Barclay
himself, who was seriously wounded by grapeshot.
My guy's there,
brother.
Frontlining it.
I know. It's like imagine just us having to take a cemetery. Like there's barely any cover. There are only tombstones.
It's crazy.
And that's if all of them are big. Most of them nowadays are so small because there's so much space they need to use. There's no cover. And that's all you got. Nah, brother. I'm good, thank you.
And you're freezing cold.
Vicious street fighting continued well into the night. But the French ultimately prevailed, with the loss of 4,000 casualties on each side. Soldiers and officers alike were astonished by the savagery of the engagement.
Yes, only a small engagement, 4,000 each side.
As darkness fell,
one day,
temperatures dropped dramatically. Many of the wounded froze to death, where they had fallen.
Oh.
The French ransacked Eylau for food and firewood. Many Russian soldiers had to sleep in open fields, wrapped only in their greatcoats, forbidden to light fires.
Oh.
That night, Napoleon's...
Brother, I'm lighting a fire!
But I like the idea that you're not giving yourself away.
Yeah.
Like, keep yourself one under a fucking blanket. Other than that, I don't care. Shut the fuck up, stop whinging.
Get close to me if you're fucking cold.
Get naked and cuddle up, body heat.
Literally, at this point, spoon me, brother, if you're fucking that cold.
I don't care. Get hard on, bro.
Just deal with it. We are not giving our position away.
Oh, that's so brutal.
Oh, so brutal. You need hard men to do something like that.
Greatest concern was that the Russians would slip away under cover of darkness, robbing him of the decisive battle he craved. He need not have worried. Bennigsen was done running. Here, at Eylau, the Russians would make their stand.
Okay. Let's see how he's gonna go.
Is something interfering with your happiness?
Yes.
Or preventing you from achieving your goals?
Yes.
If so, therapy can be a valuable tool helping you to live a happier, more fulfilled...
Get therapy, Jack.
I don't want therapy.
Yes, you do.
I need it.
You just don't have the energy to get it. It was a vast hurricane of death that seemed to smash and erase from the face of the earth everything in its path. Denis Daviod.
Before dawn, Napoleon was on Eylau's cemetery knoll, trying to make out the Russian lines through his telescope. He was surprised by what he saw. 67,000 Russians packed into two great lines along a three-mile front, with well-defended villages anchoring both flanks.
I'll bet he was regretting his choices.
Open ground lay between the two armies, providing a clear field of fire for Bennigsen's 400 guns. A huge amount of artillery for an army of the age.
Jack, if I told you to do that, well, you told me to do that.
Napoleon had Soult and Augereau's depleted corps, plus the Imperial Guard and Murat's reserve cavalry. Just 45,000 men and 137 guns.
It's something.
What?
But Napoleon
how
was expecting Davout's third corps, 15,000 men, to arrive at any moment. In perfect position to fall on the Russian flank.
I don't think they'd do it at all.
At dawn, as French troops were still getting into position, hundreds of Russian guns opened a massive bombardment.
Of course they were going to jail. What do you expect?
Yeah.
In Eylau, there was chaos.
I'm not fucking surprised.
As round shot crashed through buildings and tore through men.
Fuck.
French guns soon answered the Russians in kind.
They still got to charge through this.
It was the largest combined artillery bombardment the world had yet seen. It lasted nearly 3 hours. While Bennigsen had quantity, French crews were more experienced, and against the densely packed Russian lines,
they couldn't miss.
They couldn't miss. Shit. Not only couldn't they miss, I bet they were taking out loads
Meanwhile,
more.
Davout's two leading divisions arrived on the battlefield, dangerously placed on the Russian left flank.
God, you got two moves.
But before they could attack,
the trees,
Prince Galitzin struck first with his cavalry brigade.
Okay.
Davout's veterans threw back the horsemen with disciplined fire. Galitzin's charge, however, bought time for General Bagavut to reorganize his defensive line to face the new threat. When the Iron Marshal attacked around 8 a.m., he found the enemy entrenched on a ridge with formidable artillery support.
Okay.
Davout's lead division was mauled, suffering 1,500 casualties as it was thrown back. This check on Davout alarmed Napoleon. He feared the Russians might withdraw before his trap could close. It was, he decided, the battle's critical moment.
Is he going to make him charge?
Orders flew out to Marshal Augereau's 7th Corps and General Saint-Hilaire's division.
What did they order say,
Jack? He's going to charge.
They were to launch a frontal attack against the enemy.
You selfish little midget.
At all costs,
the
enemy's escape must be prevented.
not running, bro. It was all disorder, confusion, stupor, under an avalanche of blows. French staff officer.
The 49-year-old Marshal Augereau had been with Napoleon since his first command in Italy and the brilliant campaign of 96. But he was deeply unwell that morning. At 10 a.m., strapped to his horse, he led forward the 12,000 troops of 7th Corps, just as heavy snow began to fall.
Augereau's
divisions drifted off course, straight into the murderous artillery duel. French and Russian cannonballs tore through their ranks. Augereau's men pushed on doggedly. But as they neared the Russian line, the blizzard suddenly lifted. One division found itself facing 70 Russian guns at a range of just 30 yards.
You've got to charge at that point. If you're there,
seconds later,
you go for
its
it,
forward
right?
ranks were obliterated by Russian canister. Another.
You had absolutely no chance.
You had no chance, but if you, you're going for it, right?
You've got no chance. The second they turned around and saw that was it, they opened fire.
100%, but you're not getting away either, right? So if you turn around and you see the guns there and you're like...
Dead. That's it, dead.
I would run. I don't think I would think. I think I would just go forward. No. I'd be like, well, I'll try.
I get that. What a shame. Yeah. The second I saw him, that was game over.
Still, I would charge. Attempt.
The French division broke through the enemy line, only to be surrounded on three sides by Russian bayonets and annihilated. Augereau's horse was killed under him, leaving him badly injured. As the survivors of his corps stumbled back the way they'd come, Russian cavalry and infantry surged forward.
Shit, and the Russians can overextend.
Units were overrun. Entire regiments swallowed up. Order and discipline collapsed.
From what side?
The French.
One of the few units to maintain order was the 14th Infantry, nicknamed the Brave for its heroic role at Rivoli 10 years before.
Yeah.
But now they were outnumbered and surrounded. The regiment resisted bravely, but was cut to pieces, suffering 75% casualties and the loss of its Eagle Standard.
Shit. All those experienced soldiers just
in
gone.
In the space of just 30 minutes, the Russians inflicted 5,000 casualties on Augereau's 7th Corps. Effectively, it had ceased to exist. It was one of the worst battlefield disasters of the Napoleonic Wars. For the French, Eylau was no longer a fight for victory, but a struggle for survival.
What a boulder.
What a fuck up. Are you going to let those fellows devour us?
You're saying it right, just...
From Eylau's cemetery knoll, Napoleon watched the catastrophe engulfing Augereau's corps.
What are you going to do?
He knew he must stabilize the situation immediately.
Right now.
And buy time to reorganize his center and for Davout's corps to arrive in force. So the Emperor turned to Murat and his large cavalry reserve.
Nice. Come on.
It was a desperate gamble. The horses were tired and suffering from the cold. They'd be outnumbered and unsupported by infantry.
Come
but
on,
the flamboyant,
Murat.
Apparently fearless Marshal Murat was undaunted.
You're a good warrior.
He assembled four.
I know I've said this before in a video.
Yeah.
And I'm sticking with this shit.
Okay.
I am still shocked with the amount of fucking horses there were back then, and now there's barely fucking any.
That's because we used to breed them back then for use.
Yeah, I know, but that is just insane.
It's not, though. It's understandable. when you don't have...
Yeah, no, I get that. But what I'm saying is that
seeing
is insane.
Seeing it would be insane. But I don't think it's insane. I think it's a comparable thing for you to get your head around.
I just think it's mental. It's crazy.
How many cars do you see?
Yeah.
If you were to replace the cars with horses, that's how many horses there would be.
Yeah. I'd still say the same
thing. More. But you don't think that cars are insane? And what, seeing that many cars or tanks.
What I'm saying is to have all of that there at one time. That looks crazy. That's insane.
That's because you're not used to it. If we put a bunch of cars there...
Please just continue the video.
Squadrons of cavalry, 5,000 dragoons and cuirassiers, and led them forward.
Let us know if you think it's
so
insane.
So began one of the legendary cavalry charges of the Napoleonic Wars. Unable to move much faster than a walk due to the terrible conditions, Murat's cavalry nevertheless presented a formidable wall of men, horses and steel. General Grouchy's dragoons, in the lead, drove back the advancing Russians.
Okay.
Dartpool's steel-clad cuirassiers then thundered forward on their giant horses. Finding a gap between two Russian divisions, they used it to pry open the enemy line. With seemingly unstoppable momentum, the riders surged forward. But it could not last. As they neared Bennigsen's headquarters, a Russian battery blasted the French horsemen with canister. Dartpool himself was mortally wounded. French momentum was lost.
Shit.
As the Russian counterattack began, Murat ordered his squadrons to regroup and pull back. He almost didn't make it. The Russian 4th Division had moved to block his escape.
Shit, I told you.
Seeing this, Napoleon ordered Marshal Bessières to lead forward the Guard cavalry. These were 2,000 of the finest cavalry in Europe.
Come on.
And to cheers of Vive l'Empereur, they advanced into the whirling mass of shot and snow.
Go on, boys.
When Colonel Lepic saw his men ducking, he called out, "Heads up, by God! Those are bullets, not turds."
I like that.
Yeah,
chasseurs
man.
Chasseurs of the Guard charged down the first Russian infantry square they met, scattered the enemy's gunners, and cut out a path for Murat's retreating squadrons.
Big plays.
The French charge at Eylau would go down as one of the boldest, most desperate military manoeuvres of the age. The losses were terrible in men and horses,
but
it succeeded in its mission. The Russian advance had been stopped in its tracks, and the initiative had swung back to Napoleon.
Recuperating these lines. Such a back and forth fucking battle, isn't it, Jack?
This is mental.
All attrition on both sides was now riveted on Davout and our left wing.
Marshal Davout's Third Corps, the famed heroes of Auerstedt 4 months before, had now arrived in sufficient force to launch a full-scale assault.
Okay.
Anticipating this, Bagovut withdrew to a new defensive line on the Kriegerberge, a dominating height perfect for artillery. 2 hours of chaotic fighting followed, with every French advance challenged by a fierce Russian counterattack. But supported by Dragoons and Saint-Hilaire's division, Third Corps slowly ground down the enemy.
Slowly, though.
Bennigsen was forced to send in his last reserve, Kaminsky's 14th division. Supported by cavalry, it drove the French from Kleinsausgarten and across the fields beyond, until its own advance was checked by French artillery. When Davout resumed his attack at 3 p.m., the Russian line buckled. The Kriegerberge was taken.
There we go, that's it.
That cavalry.
So too, Bennigsen's headquarters at Auklappen. Bennigsen scraped together enough units to improvise a new defensive line, but French guns, hauled up to the Kriegerberger, opened up a devastating fire.
Look at it. Yeah, I don't think there's any.
The French pressure was irresistible. The Russian flank would surely collapse at any moment, handing Napoleon the decisive victory he so desperately sought.
No, you're right. Look, he's really good.
All that was required was one final push.
Notion has been the centerpiece. Fuck you. Well, not fuck you. Give YouTubers money. Of my brain. I can take no. Good God, the Prussians are here too. French officer in Alou.
Early that morning, Bennigsen had sent urgent orders to Prussian General Anton von Listock to join the main army with his corps as quickly as possible. Although nearly 70, Listock was still as energetic as he'd been serving under Frederick the Great, and was assisted by a highly capable chief of staff, Colonel Gerhard von Scharnhorst. Lestock's corps, 9,000 men, was 8 miles northwest of Eylau, closely watched by Marshal Ney's 6th Corps.
Come on, Ney.
His orders were to prevent the Prussians linking up with the Russians at all costs.
Okay, simple.
Oh, I don't.
But by force marching his troops along frozen, hilly country roads, Lestock was able to bypass Ney's blocking force.
Shit.
Oh dear.
To Bennigsen's joy, by early afternoon, the Prussians had reached Schmoditen. With his left flank crumbling, there was no time to lose. At 4 p.m, Listock's Prussians charged forward.
Shit.
By now, Davout's men had been marching and fighting for many hours, and were utterly spent. They managed a few ragged volleys before they turned and ran.
Once you see reinforcements,
Russian cavalry followed in pursuit. Marshal Davout, with just one intact division left, prepared to make a stand on the Kriegerberger.
Okay.
The brave, he shouted, will find a glorious death here. Fortunately for Davout, the enemy's attacks were poorly coordinated, and his 40-gun battery inflicted terrible losses.
Nice.
Around 5:30, as dusk fell, Ney's corps arrived in pursuit of the Prussians and took Schlöditen.
It's now
this new threat forced Bennigsen to call off his attack on Davout. And as darkness descended, the day's slaughter finally came to an end.
No matter where one looked, one saw nothing but corpses and behind men dragging.
Since Napoleon had crowned himself emperor in 1804, every campaign, every battle he'd waged, had ended in brilliant success.
Not this one.
No longer. Bennigsen, learning the true scale of his army's losses and its critical shortage of ammunition, withdrew overnight.
Yeah, you had to.
The French were left holding a frozen, corpse-strewn battlefield, allowing Napoleon to claim a victory. But in reality, Eylau had been a murderous slaughter without a winner.
Yeah.
As Marshal Ney exclaimed on seeing the battlefield, what a massacre. And without result.
I mean,
exact casualty figures are unknown due to the chaos and conditions of the battle and the scale of loss. But it is likely that the Russians lost 20,000 men, killed, wounded, or captured. The French, perhaps as many as 25,000. What is clear is that thousands of French veterans, the victors of Ulm, Austerlitz and Jena, met their end on the snowy fields of East Prussia.
Ah, that's such a big hit to his
Napoleon's army. Grande Armée would go on to achieve many more great victories, including a crushing victory over Bennigsen's Russians at Friedland 4 months later. But after the brutal losses of Eylau, it was never the same.
That's crazy. That's crazy. What an amazing
thank
video
you to the artists Keith
again.
Rocco and Alexander Avrianov for kind permission to use their artworks in this video.
Yo,
big thanks also to our old collaborator. His
big shout out
big
to
up
them.
To these two, man. Their artwork is insane.
Definitely.
Thank you
history
very much
for creating the battlefield map used in this episode. You can enjoy many more excellent military history videos on his own YouTube channel. And thank you to all Patreon supporters who voted for this topic and make this channel possible. Visit our Patreon page to find out how you can support our work, help choose future topics, and get ad-free early access to new videos.
You know what you need to do. Go over to their channel, subscribe if you haven't already. The link's in the description box down below. They make amazing content. Check out their Patreon too, because they said that. And also they shout out History Marsh. So definitely check out their channel as well. If you enjoyed our reaction, you know what you need to do. You need to like, comment, subscribe, hit that notification bell, and we will catch you in the next video.
I need to pee.